I'll leave it up to you to decide how weird and interesting and amazing it is. But first of all, I need to tell you this is a long presentation. The problem about this kind of presentation is that it's very much a lifetime of research and putting things together, and then specifically the last 7 years, compiling knowledge and information and research and discovery, and the body of evidence just keeps growing and growing and growing. So you reach a stage where do you cut off? What do you leave out, which is less important than everything else? And it really has become a problem. So this is the last tour that I'll be doing talking about this. And you're probably going to be the last group of people seeing this presentation. But the problem is, what do you cut out? So it's not easy. I've squeezed it into probably about 3 hours. So we're going to do 1.5 and 1.5 hours with a break in between. If you doze off, it's okay. Don't worry about it. You'll take it in subconsciously. And I'll send one of the henchmen to wake you up. First of all, some big thank yous, because this has been a really turbulent arrival in Canada from the USA yesterday, and it's been just been one thing after the other. And I need to say, if it wasn't for David and his beautiful wife, who I'm still to meet.
She's on her way.
Monica, right?
That's right.
David, please stand up so everybody can see you. This is the guy that actually helped you put everything together, amongst other people. And he's a martial arts expert, if you don't know that, so be careful. He's the henchman, I will say. And then from the Dowsers Association, Marilyn Gang, who we met in Vermont when we started out. Thank you, Marilyn. And Marion as well. Marilyn and Marion, thank you. And then also the lady that helped us booking things and so forth, Anya Dreamchild, who can't be here, from Ottawa. And all the other people that have given us support on the internet, and especially my beautiful girlfriend Louise, who met you at the door, who's putting up with me while we travel. Thank you, my baby. So I'm going to take this at a pace. If there are things that seem like they're missing, do not despair. They've probably just been taken out. We can talk for at least an hour or two on every slide. And I know that many of you are already deeply and widely informed and educated. And I love to learn from my audiences and the people that I talk to. And that is really for the travels that I've been doing, especially in the North America the last 3 years. I've learned a great deal of new information that keeps adding support to the research that I do myself. And that's really exciting for me personally. So let's ground ourselves. This is where we live, people. Some people say it's not a very good address. It's exposed to possible anarchy, chaos, and so forth. But from a distance, it's a beautiful symbol of sacred geometry and unity. Absolutely beautiful, unified planet. And isn't it look peaceful? So beautiful. But as you start closing in, everything changes. And the closer you get, the more dramatically it changes, until you get and land on this planet and you realize how completely and utterly screwed up everything has become. Unfortunately, that's the reality we face from day to day. How has that happened? And I'm starting at this point specifically because I'm going to end here. Because out of the research that I've done, I've reached certain conclusions that prevent me from moving ahead with anything else about the past, but focusing specifically on the future and helping us find a shining bright light at this gloomy tunnel, or in this gloomy tunnel that we seem to face on a daily basis. And that's, for me, the most exciting thing that I've discovered, is what do we do with this knowledge and information? So I'm starting at this point because I'm going to end at this point as well. And if I don't, remind me. The history of our planet is a lot stranger and a lot more mysterious than anyone of us could possibly imagine. And I'm going to really speak about the last 300,000 years or so about human history. Since we, as species called Homo sapiens, magically appeared on this beautiful blue, pale blue dot. And the arguments about that keep continuing. They go on. The evolutionists versus the creationists, and it goes like a dingbat. Left to right, all the time. Who's right? Who's wrong? What if both of them were right? And that to me is very, very exciting, because it seems to me that that seems to be the case at both of them, actually, right? But they both, the sites seem to be missing some very important bits of information that they, that's the part they keep arguing about. The great human puzzle: who are we? Where do we come from? Why are we here? The three simple fundamental questions that we cannot answer, as smart as we think we are. If we knew all this stuff, if we were as smart as we thought we are, we should be able to answer these questions very, very simply, very easily. And we can't do that. I have a serious problem with that. This should be the first three questions, or these should be the first three questions that we just slide through. We should know this. If we don't know who we are and where we come from, how could we possibly think we know where we are going? If we don't know the past, and we don't know the road and the path we've traveled, how can we know what the direction is that we're traveling in? At this stage, we're behaving, and we are a species with amnesia. We're like a free radical floating around in space. We can go in any direction right now, because we have no clue about who we are and where we come from. And I'm talking about the majority of the human race. Most of you seem to be enlightened already. And that's why you're here. That's why you discuss these kind of things. That's why you want to learn more and you're open to these things. But that's not necessarily the case. But there is a bright light at the end of this tunnel. This thing called rise of consciousness, right? And we see that happening around us on a daily basis. So you find some interesting things like this in the Gospel of Thomas, these apocryphal books that are really beautiful when you discover some real amazing truths in them, like this here. The disciples said to Jesus, "Tell us how our end will be." And he said, "Have you discovered the beginning then, that you look for the end? For where the beginning is, there will be the end. Blessed is he who takes his place at the beginning. He will know the end and will not experience death." It's amazing that the prophets and the wise men and women of the past have given us this information over and over and over again, but we just don't want to hear it. How many more prophets have to come, and teachers, great teachers, thousands and thousands of years, have to come and share this information with us, and we just ignore them? First of all, we ignore them, then we ridicule them, then we either torture them or kill them. And then, once we've done that, we completely skew their message, distort their message, and use it against them to wrestle up a horde of people to believe something completely different from what they were actually trying to teach us. And that seems to be the story with all major religions. And I believe that this is the time that we unweave ourselves from that spell. We are taught in the Bible that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. Well, you know what? It's an incorrect translation. And once again, I have a problem with these kind of things, and I need to bring it to your attention. The brilliant Michal Lidwith, one of the wisest and smartest theological students in the world, made an amazing discovery while he was still a student. And he discovered when you put the letter Aleph, or the first Hebrew letter of the Hebrew alphabet, that is compulsory to put at the beginning of every religious text. If you place it where it belongs, everything changes. The entire meaning of that opening phrase in Hebrew of the Bible changes. I'm not going to give it to you in Hebrew because it's far too hectic on your throat. But this is what Michal discovered. When you put the letter Aleph at the beginning of the opening phrase of the Bible, this is what it says. The Father of the beginnings created the Elohim, the heavens and the earth. And everything changes. And we discover the Elohim, the many gods of the Bible, that it always has been. Remember, the Elohim is a plural for the gods. Never a singular. How and why it became a singular in today's Bibles is a really interesting story. And I'm sure if you don't know that yet, I seriously suggest you go look for those answers. And we discover the activities of these Elohim, and then the Nephilim, and the Seraphim, and all these weird beings that we encounter in the Bible, and their reflections in other ancient religious texts, and we know very little about them. Yet, all these ancient texts refer to them in ways as if we should know exactly who these people were. They just randomly throw them out there, which means that they obviously knew who they were, otherwise they wouldn't just write about them as if they were, you know, like saying, oh, the Americans came down from America, and we don't know who the Americans are. Well, we don't know who the Elohim and the Nephilim are. Well, some of us are finding out. And it's always about gold. You cannot separate human history from our obsession with gold. It's not possible. It is the primary obsession of the gods and not necessarily the people. This is the big separation. It is not the people that were obsessed with gold. It was always the gods. When those thugs from Europe started colonizing the rest of the world around 500 years ago, and some call them the explorers, I like to call them the thugs, because that's really what they did, just steal other countries away from everybody around the world and call it their own, decimate the populations, and sever the native populations from their ancestors. That is a very important thing I'd like you to think about, because it was such a cunning and beautifully, maliciously executed plot that today we are suffering as a species with amnesia because of what they did around 500 years ago. That's when they really started severing the ancients from our knowledge base and turning us today into these people that say, oh, the ancient people, they knew nothing. Who are they? They're just a bunch of idiots. They lived in the past. We got cell phones, we got computers, we got the internet, we technologically advanced, we can fly in the sky, we can all this, do all this stuff. They knew nothing. That's when the crime happened, I believe. Severing us from our ancestors, the acknowledging, the honoring of our ancestors, not realizing that they had thousands of years of oral tradition that they held very, very dear, that we just decimated. And that part of that information was the gold that belonged to the gods. Because whenever they were asked, who does this gold belong to? It was always, the gold belongs to the gods. And that's just spectacular. It's not our obsession. In Genesis 2, we can see how this obsession runs and how deeply it runs. Adam is alone on earth, people. Eve had not yet been fashioned from his rib. And God comes to him and says, hey Adam, there's this place called Havilah, where the land is good, the water is good, and by the way, buddy, there is gold. It wasn't Adam that was obsessed with gold, it was the gods, the Elohim. And in that one defining moment, we separate the God with a big G and the gods with a small G, right there in Genesis 2. And the twain shall never meet. And what surprises me over and over again is when scholars and learned people that have studied this stuff for decades and decades keep crossing the line all the time between the divine creator, source of all things, a God with a big G that I would like to refer to, and the gods with a small G, a bunch of advanced beings, whatever planet they're from, with advanced technology that understand the process of cloning and manipulating other beings, and they keep crossing that line. God with a big G, God with a small G. And here is probably the first time in the Bible that we see that. A beautiful example that we need to pay attention to. And then the golden surprise hits us. This golden thing keeps happening all the way through the Bible and all other ancient texts. When Moses came down from the mountain, there he saw the golden calf. What did he do with the calf? He put it in the fire and he burnt the calf in the fire. And what did he turn it into? Not into molten gold, which all of us, our minds imagine molten gold, but that's not what happened. He turned it into white powder. And in 2, they don't just tell this to us once in the Bible, they repeat it in 2 consecutive books, in Exodus and Deuteronomy, just to make sure they drive it in. He turned the gold into white powder. What on earth is, when does gold turn into white powder? And what did he do with that white powder? He put it in the water and made the Israelites drink it. What's going on here? Something weird is going on here. Clearly, Moses was an alchemist. And that's exactly what he was. If you follow Moses' history, he grew up as a privileged young man in Egypt, went to the mystery schools in Egypt. He was an accomplished alchemist. He knew stuff that we can't even begin to imagine in today's society. That's why he could turn the gold into white powder of gold. And that's really the obsession of the gods. The monatomic form of gold, not the golden surprise, the gold, shiny gold that we are so obsessed with. That's the slaves, the people that were given the shiny gold. And very sparingly, when needed, like in the desert, when they were needed to be kept alive, if that in fact and indeed is a true story, that remains, you know, open for debate. What is monatomic gold? Orbitally rearranged monatomic elements, as David Hudson calls it. White powder form. Non-metallic. Has no metallic properties whatsoever. The Egyptians called it muftak. It means, what is it? It's also referred to in the Bible as manna from heaven, and bread of God, and that kind of stuff. And it acts as a superconductor, this powdery substance. It emits a single frequency of white light. It heats faulty cells. It heals faulty cells. In other words, it cures disease. And it also realigns our DNA. It has anti-gravity properties. When you bring your hand under it, as David Hudson describes in the laboratory, it starts to float above your hand, which suggests that our bodies themselves, because it's not metallic, it has no magnetic properties, it suggests that our bodies themselves have monoatomic elements in them, and therefore we repel the monoatomic gold when we bring our hand underneath it. And it transmutes between 700 and 800 degrees Celsius. What do I mean by that? When David Hudson started to heat this up in the laboratory, by 700 degrees Celsius, it started to disappear. There's a little pile of white powder. By 800 degrees, that pile of powder was gone, vanished from sight. Gone. Now, you're not going to read about this anyway in any scientific book or journal. Why? Because there's some unwritten law in academia that states that you cannot write in any scientific papers anything that you cannot explain with our current knowledge of science. It is the most ridiculous kind of thing that we can imagine. So all the surprises that happen in the laboratories that we can't explain, we're not allowed to write about, and nobody is ever going to read about the stuff that they can't explain in the laboratories. It's insane. The 700 and 800 degrees people, that is really important, because that's like so intricately related and encoded and linked to sacred geometry and the numbers and what I call numeric science that my dear friend Willem de Swart in Johannesburg has become an absolute supreme master of, decoding this numeric matrix that we seem to find ourselves in on this planet and in this reality. And that 700 and 800 number is not just an average or an accidental number, and that is why that powder disappearing there just gave me so much joy, because it confirms a lot of stuff that I already knew from Willem de Swart that we studied and looked at, where things disappear. 7 and 8. Remember, we work with floating point arithmetic, so 700, 800 is the same as 7 and 8, or 7,000 or 70,000, 7 and 8, same thing. So all about this gold, and all of Southern African history is inextricably linked to gold. You can't separate Southern African history from gold. And also the Monomotapa kingdom, as you can see in the middle here. The Monomotapa kings that were attacked by every ancient civilization and could not be conquered. The golden kings of Monomotapa that had all the golden power in the world. They supplied the whole world with gold. The Phoenicians, the Indians, the Chinese, everyone got their gold from the kings of Monomotapa. You won't generally find this information in most history books. What I find fascinating, and there's the port of Sofala there in Mozambique. It's no longer there, it's under the sea. Today the town of Beira is on the coast of Mozambique, where Sofala used to be. And they used to come down the coast here, and this is in recent times that I'm talking about, like 2000 BC, up to about 2000 BC, and then come inland and get the gold from here.